Morning, everyone. Morning, Dasha. Okay, let me just wait a couple more minutes to see if anybody else shows up. If anybody has any questions, you can throw that out there. Morning, Kayla. While you're getting yourself organized to take notes and do whatever we're going to do in the class, I was going to tell you that I know I was mentioning the other day that in the collaborative groups, students were starting to really use their phones to text each other a picture of some problem that they were having difficulty with. Well, my other two classes of MAT1100 have decided to start using it while I'm giving a lecture to send me pictures of problems that they encountered in Alex that they may have had a hard time with. And I think most of the texts that I got during the lecture yesterday, during yesterday's lectures, were the ones concerning fractions. So, you know, I just want to remind you that I can put my number right there in the chat box. And if you do want to text me, I guess that would be the, you know, the easiest way, although I could make everyone a presenter and you could share something on your screen if you'd like, but it's probably pretty darn easy to take a picture of something that you've been working on and just text it to me. So that's an option if anybody wants to throw out a question that they've been having trouble with. Let's see. Okay, so we're going to be doing section 3.5 today. I will, you know, just give you a heads up that there's only two more sections left in this chapter. 3.7 and 3.10 are the other two sections that we'll cover next. Let's see, what's today? Well, we'll cover 3.7 this week and 3.10 next week. Anyway, we're getting close to the end of the chapter, so be thinking about the portfolios that are assigned in this chapter and maybe start doing, you know, one or two of those just to get them out of the way so they don't all pile up at the end. I mean, I know you probably have your own system. Maybe some of you prefer to do them all at the end. It just takes a little stress off when you kind of space them out. Other than that, I also wanted to remind you, I've already said this a couple of times, that spring registration has started. And the classes that you, the options you have for the next class, it's very, very highly suggested that you take your math classes back to back because students tend to do much better in the next two classes, whichever one you choose. And you may have to take two more classes. Maybe you only have to take one more class. I guess that's based on whatever you're getting your, whatever degree you're going after. But you have an option for the next class of either 2106 or 2107. If anyone needs to talk to me about specific teachers that teach that course, they're all good, but I happen to know the names of some of them that teach them quite often if you need recommendations. And they fill up pretty quickly, so I just thought I would remind you of that. Anybody have any questions or concerns that they want to share with me? Okey-doke. Okay, let's get going then. I'm going to do the problems from the lessons note packet first, and that's on page 42, and then I'm going to do some of the problems from the book that, you know, are the favorites that seem to pop up in Alex and on the test quite a bit. And then that'll be it for section 3.5. Okay, so let me switch over to my document camera. Feel free to stop me if you have any questions or anything that you need re-explained. Okay, so what you're doing in this section is application problems. A lot of what you're doing is you're trying to translate a verbal description of some issue or problem, and you're trying to take that and translate it into a mathematical expression or an equation. Now this one actually has, you know, the ones that with the that have to do with the shapes, they tend to come with a picture. And I would also suggest that if they do give you a problem with, you know, that has anything to do with rectangle, squares, any kind of geometrical shape, that you're probably going to want to draw a picture of it and label the sides with whatever it is they're talking about in the problem, because that'll help you to get oriented much better and have a better feeling, you know, better understanding of how to set it up. So in this one, pretty straightforward. They've labeled the sides with either a variable or a constant. They're all considered mathematical expressions. So each side is labeled. And they're saying that the labelings on each side represent the lengths of each side. So even though some of them are variables containing x and some of them are just constants, whatever is there represents the length. So then they would like you to form an expression for the perimeter, and you just have to know that perimeter, regardless of the shape, means to add all the sides. So when you come up with the expression here, you can start on any side you want. It doesn't matter. I'll start right here. And then just go all the way around. 3, next one's 9, next one's 5x, next one's 4, and the next one 8x. Okay, so there's the side, and then they want the perimeter simplified. So one of the things that you've learned in this chapter, as well as the previous chapter, is that when you simplify, you just combine like terms. So these are all constants. In other words, they don't have x's on them. So those are all considered like terms, 3 plus 9 plus 4. So 3 and 9 is 12. You can do it in your calculator if you'd like. 12 and 4, 16. So that combines this, this, and this. Then as far as the x's go, it's 5x and 8x. 5 and 8 is 13. With an x on it. You're just combining the coefficients. When you combine like terms that have variables, you don't add up the powers. That's for when you're multiplying them, if you're a little rusty on the rules for exponents. Right? Don't add the exponents when you're just doing addition or subtraction. You only add the coefficients. Okay? So there is your answer, all simplified for perimeter. Next problem has to do with area. So the area of a rectangular parking lot is 8,360 square meters, because area is in square units always. If the width of the parking lot is 84, what is the length? So you might want to have a picture, although you could do it straight from the formula. Picture may help people who are very visual, like myself. So this would be the length, this would be the width. They're telling you that all of this area inside, as though you were mowing a lawn or painting a surface, is 8,316 meters squared. That's the entire area. Area has a formula when it comes to every shape has a different area formula. The one for rectangles is length times width. It can also be written base times height. These were all in chapter 2, and then they come up again here. And so they're telling you that the width is 84 meters. So both of these are the widths, these both of these are the lengths. Anyway, this is 84 meters. And then it goes on to say, what is the length? So if you have a formula, the formula is what you're plugging into in order to solve the problem, which is what they're asking you to do. They're asking you to solve for length. You want to know what the length is. So you're always using the formula for that. Whether or not you decide to draw a picture, that's up to you, but it seems to be helpful for students. And then just start plugging in. So, and you got to plug in the numbers where they belong. Like for instance, this number 8316, that's the area. Therefore, it has to be plugged in for A. So 8316, that's meters squared. And then the length, we don't know what the length is, but it's multiplied. In this formula, it says length is multiplied by width. That's where your 84 meters would go. And then you learn, let's see if I can write this a little bit better, a little bit clearer. I'm going to move this over a little bit. Okay, there we go. Okay, so what you've been learning how to do in this particular chapter is how to solve equations. And you've been learning that whatever you're solving for, in this case, it's going to be the L that you see here, because they've asked you to solve for L, is that you're trying to remove any numbers that are next to the variable you're solving by. You're solving for by using the opposite operation, the inverse operation. So since these are attached by multiplication, opposite operation is to divide. You're going to divide by 84 meters, and you always have to do the same thing both sides. So that's been the emphasis of this chapter, solving equations, although there have been some equations in other chapters. This 1 meter that you see down here cancels with one of the meters here, because meters squared is really meters times meters. So this 1 meter takes out one of those, and there's one of them left, which makes sense because length is in regular meters, not meters squared. As far as the numeric portion of your answer, you can just pop that in your calculator. So that would be, let me get rid of this. 8316 divided by 84, and you get 99, and there's that 1 meter left. That's your answer. So another geometry problem. Okay, and the problem down below it, we switch back to perimeter. So let's see, it says the perimeters of the pool, all the way around the pool of a rectangular pool, is 316. If the length of the pool is 97, what is the width? Again, a picture may help you. I'm going to draw one. Okay, so this will be the rectangular pool. Okay, it says perimeter is 316. That's all the way around, so you can't put that on the sides because it incorporates all the sides. The length is 97, so this will be the length. And therefore, this is also 9 meters because, you know, these are both equal. It says these widths are both equal. So you don't know what the width is. You do know that the perimeter, and there's a formula for the perimeter. It's just add up all the sides. It just so happens that you have two sides called length. So we have two of these, and we have two of these. You can use multiplication to, you know, just to express the fact that you have two of the same thing when you're talking about length as well as width. Okay, so our length in this particular problem is 9, so we can go ahead and put that in. Our width, we don't know what the width is. We're trying to solve for that, and our perimeter is 316. So here you get 18, and this is meters. Over here you have 316 meters plus 2W. I'm going to have to finish this over here. Okay, so if you're going to solve this, let me just carry the whole thing back over here so you can watch what I'm doing. This is what we call a two-step equation. We were really going over various types of equations in section 3.3. And there was one-step problems, two-step problems, and there was also the cross-multiplying where you use the reciprocal to get rid of a multiplier. I think that was mainly the emphasis of the questions that students were throwing at me yesterday that they were texting me. There were problems in ALS where you had to get rid of a fraction, but you didn't use multiplying by a reciprocal. And I can share with you what more than one or two students spoke to me about a confusion that they had regarding when to use the reciprocal and when it doesn't really apply. So we'll talk about that later, but continuing to solve that, you would just move the 18 over here, because always the last thing that you try to get rid of is this coefficient. So we're going to move this by using a negative 18 meters. And you would get, gosh, I'm running out of real estate here. Okay, 316 minus 18 would be 298. 298 meters is equal to, now let's just get rid of this M because you're going to get it confused with, oops, this was a W. This was the 2 times W. And I guess I'll leave that there. So this was 2W. All right, so I subtracted 18 meters from there, 18 meters from here. 316 minus 18 is 298. I'm still trying to solve for W. If you do want to leave the units off of the problem while you're doing it and then just put it back on at the end, that's up to you. You can do that if you want, just so you don't accidentally think that it's a variable. So this is just a unit. This is the variable we're solving for. So we're dividing by 2 on both sides. We end up with W is equal to 149. And you can put that in your calculator. And it's 149 meters. So if you want to put that in your calculator, just 298 divided by 2, 149. Okay, and I think that is all that was asked for there. This was 99. Okay, this last problem. This one has to do with fractions. So it's possible that multiplying by the reciprocal might apply here. It depends whether it's a multiply or not. If it's a coefficient, then yeah, you're going to get rid of it by multiplying by the reciprocal. But if all it is a fraction that you're adding or subtracting to something, then using a reciprocal does not apply in that situation. And that's what some students, like 3 students, were confused about. Seemed to be a popular question yesterday. Okay, so it says Jim is on his way home. He has driven 12 miles so far, which is 3/4 of the way home. When they say the way home, they're talking about the distance to get home. That would be another way of saying that in case that's confusing to you. What is the total length of his drive or the total distance? Okay, so if you want, just because they've used the word length here, the entire length of your trip home is the entire distance that it takes to get home. So you could use L for how far it is to get home. And then let's go over some key words here. He has driven 12 miles so far. This 12 miles is, the word is stands for the equal sign, because you're going from words into an equation. That's called translating a mathematical description. And that's what they're describing to you here, a mathematical. They're trying to describe mathematically what's going on, and you're going to take it a step further and translate it into numbers and mathematical symbols. So the word is stands for equals. When you see of, that means multiply, not an x, it means multiply. I don't want you to get confused with that. So now let's take these phrases from the word 12 all the way here to try and create an equation. 12 miles, forget about the phrase so far, 12 miles is, I'm going to leave the units off right now, 12 miles is 3/4 of means multiply. And you know, when you put a number right up against a variable, that indicates multiplication. You can indicate multiplication with a dot, with an X, with a parenthesis. But when we're writing equations and we want to indicate two things are multiplied together, especially a number and a variable, we just put them right up against each other. That indicates multiplication. So 3/4 of the distance home, the entire distance we're calling the length. How long, you know, what is the length in miles to get home? So 3/4 of the entire distance. Okay, now that is a situation where you're using the reciprocal to solve for L. And that's because this is a multiplier. So I kind of explained it using the reciprocal because that's a shortcut, but really what you're doing is this, but that would cause you a lot of extra thinking and a lot of extra steps. So I shortened the thinking process for you. This is really what you're doing when you're multiplying by reciprocal. This is being multiplied by 3/4. You're really, and I'm going to erase this in a minute because I want you to stick to thinking of it in the most simplistic manner. But I want you to understand that the overriding theme for all of these equation solving problems is that you undo an attachment to the variable by performing the opposite operation. So some of you may be wondering, why is she all of a sudden talking about a reciprocal? I thought she said that you're supposed to do the opposite each time in order to break their attachment. I am still doing the opposite because look, this is being multiplied by 3/4, so let's divide by 3/4. But in mathematics, dividing, I mean, you will always get the same answer if you understand this. Dividing by anything, I don't care what you're dividing by, it is equivalent. In other words, you will get the same answer if instead of dividing by that number, you multiply by the reciprocal. They are considered equivalent operations. Dividing by any number, whether it's a fraction or not, is equivalent to, that means the same as, multiplying by the reciprocal. You will get the same answer. It's just that multiplying is an easier operation. So we just tell students multiply by the reciprocal because it really is the same. See, this looks complicated because you have a fraction divided by another fraction, but it is the same thing. You'll get the same answer without it looking so messy as multiplying by the reciprocal instead of doing that. And that's why I took you right into that shortcut when I taught you how to solve these. But I really am still doing the same operation where I'm performing the opposite operation. So multiplying by the reciprocal here, multiplying by the reciprocal here. On this side, the 4s cancel, the 3s cancel, leaving you with just an L. And then over here is where you do the calculation. And you just have to remember that on the side where you're actually doing calculation, you just multiply top times top, not too hard to remember. And you do bottom times bottom. And then you let your calculator handle the rest. Just 48 divided by 3, 16. The problem had to do with miles, and so you can go and put the unit miles in there. Okay, so at the point where he had gone 12, that 12 was 3/4 of the way home. What was the entire distance home? 16 miles. That's your final answer there. So everything on this page has been about you going from a verbal description. See, in section 3.3, we just gave you the equation and tried to get you to understand, how do I undo the operations I'm seeing so that I remove everything from the variable that I'm trying to solve for? This section obviously goes a step higher than that. Instead of them just handing you the equation, you create the equation. So you can expect, you know, 4 or 5 problems like that on the test. Let me practice with you a little bit more because, again, this section's about application. It's about really a lot about your reading comprehension, being able to read the problem. Most people, when they're doing a word problem, read it 3-4 times. I read it 3 or 4 times just so I can stress to you what it is that you should be picking out of the words, because some of the words don't matter. They are irrelevant with regard to you setting up the picture or the equation. And that's what you have to get good at. A lot of people use a highlighter when they're trying to do a word problem, and they try to look for specific things that have to do with setting up the equation, like the word is that signifies the equal sign. The word of, as I just pointed out, that signifies multiplication. You try to pinpoint words like that, because if you see the word is, like in the last problem that I just did, before the word is are the things that go on one side of the equation. Notice here's my equal sign. The 12 that they mentioned right before the word is, that was the only thing I had on the left-hand side. And then what's mentioned after the word is 3/4 of the total distance. That's what goes on the other side. So people that get good eventually, or you know, get the best that they can be at solving word problems, they're looking for cues like that, often highlighting things that will mean specific operations or equal signs. Okay, let's go on to some of these other application problems. Okay, this is page 343 in the book, section 3.5. And they talk about POIA's four-step procedure for solving problems. Understand the problem usually means reading it a few times, highlighting words that indicate operations or equal signs, come up with a plan to solve the problem, and then check your answer. Okay, so in this problem, let's try and set up an equation that's going to allow us to solve this. Okay, so we have some room here. Okay, so we have Jack and Diane are going to start saving for retirement. Second sentence. They deposited $1,000 in an account to start out, and they're going to deposit $50 each month. I've seen this very often in Alex and also on the test. How long will it take until they've deposited $4,500? So you don't have specific cues like is the word is and the word of. That last problem that I just did was clearer if you are familiar with the fact that is means equal and of means multiply. Here, I think it's just more common sense. They're starting off with $1,000. They deposited $1,000, and then they're going to be on a plan where they're going to add $50. I mean, that's what deposit means. You're going to add to your account, so that's why I know it's an addition sign. That's what I mean by common sense. I mean, when we were doing the banking account problems, almost everyone understood that deposit means add to your account, or you became familiar with it while learning the section. And you know that when you debit from your account, it takes money out of your account. So if you're taking money out of your account, you're subtracting. And when you're putting money in your account, you're adding. So it says in this particular problem, and I'm just going to, in the book, they try to draw the steps from you one step at a time, but we'll just go ahead and set up the whole equation. You're starting off with $1,000. You're adding to that, because you're depositing money, $50 times the number of weeks that you decide to save for. We'll put W for the number of weeks that you're saving for. So maybe you're going to continue saving for 6 weeks. Maybe you're going to continue saving for 20 weeks. Maybe you're going to save for 100 weeks. So this W will be the number of weeks, because how much money you end up with in your account is going to be number of weeks. Let's say it's 20 times 50 for each of those 20 weeks, and it'll get added on to what you started with. So that's kind of the plan that we have in this savings account. We want to know how long will it take, how many weeks will it take until they've deposited, until their total number of deposits, remember this was a deposit, this was their initial deposit, this is their weekly deposit. And you can maybe put that there also. $50 times W is the weekly deposit. So, you know, it keeps changing, which is why it's called a variable, because it can vary. If it's 1 week, you've ended up in your account with $50 plus 1,000. If it's 2 weeks, 2 times 50 is 100, 100 plus 1,000. And you see how it just keeps going up. If this is 3, it'd be 150 plus 1,000. They want to know when this total depositing plan is equal to $4,500. And so you see, you've created an equation, and then you jump onto your skills for solving an equation. So when you solve for W, you're going to be figuring out exactly how many weeks it takes at $50 a week, being that you started with 1,000 to get all the way up to 4,500. Okay, so let's solve that. We're going to subtract the, let me move it down here so I can get it out of the, all the words that I just wrote there. Okay, so we're going to subtract 1,000. The reason I'm subtracting is because the only way to make a positive 1,000 move, you really look at the sign here. It's not so much this sign, it's what kind of sign this number has. So since it's positive, if I want it to go away, I need a negative. That's the same thing as subtracting. Subtract 1,000 there as well. And then here you have 50W is equal to 3,500. And then the second step would be, just like the last problem that I just did on the lessons note packet, this is also a two-stepper. This was step one, where I subtracted. You always get rid of this coefficient as your last move. I'm going to divide by 50 now on both sides. Zeros would cancel, so 5 into 35 would be 7 with that extra zero, but you can just put it in your calculator. Okay, so this was step two where I did the division, and we've been practicing a lot of two-step solving problems, two-step equations. Anybody have any questions for me so far? Okay. All right, let's go to page 5. Okay, so now we're going to do a polling problem. I want you to get involved yourself now. Read this problem that you're seeing here and try to set it up, and you're going to see a polling question appear in a couple of minutes. Read that first. The problem that says, did you get it? This would be similar to, and I'll talk you through it a little bit. This would be similar to what I just did. Let's see. So it says, manufacturer of a custom drinking mugs has a fixed setup cost. You know how the banking account problem that I just did, they started with 1,000? Well, this guy, he's trying to get some things made for his business, and they charge $1,000 just to get the machinery set up that's going to make the mugs. That's what they call a setup. It's the same thing as saying, oh, your initial deposit in your account was $1,000. And then you're just adding on. It's just that in this problem, the money that you're seeing here, it's costing the business owner that much money. Whereas in the last problem, that money was money that was being saved in an account. So very similar problem. $1,000 just to set up the machinery. And then his bill. So he's already spent $1,000. And then his bill, his costs, are going to go up. In other words, addition. For each mug, maybe you can use M for the number of mugs, and he's going to spend $1.50 times however many mugs he has made. we want to know when that spending plan, $1,000 to set up the machinery plus $1.50 per mug, when does it total $2,800? Okay, try to set up that problem, and then you'll see a question appearing in a couple of minutes. Okay, so you probably solved it by now. Excuse that typo. It was supposed to say $1,000 setup cost plus $1.50 per mug, like it said in the book. Pick what you think is the answer. Hopefully everybody heard me. That was supposed to say $1,000 setup cost. I was just copying what was in the book, trying to copy it. Okay, so I think that's, well, there was 8 people. Don't know what happened to the 8th person, but... Let's see, I have answers from 7 people. Okay, so let's go, let me review it. I can't tell if yours is going through Brooklyn. Just know which one that you chose and then just see if you got it right. All I got is 7 people that answered, but it doesn't tell me exactly who. Okay, so here we go. Let's go over this, show responses. Okay, so there was one choice of one person chose 1,000. Everybody else chose 1,200. Let's look at what the setup is here. So switching back over to me, this problem would be just set up just like the banking problem that I just did. It would be $1,000 just to set up the machinery. You're paying that $1,000 right off the bat. Plus, you're also going to pay $1.50 for each mug that you get made for your business. So $1.50 times however many mugs you're going to get made. And they want to know when this costs, because all of this is included in your cost, $1,000 to set up the machine and $1.50 in materials to make each mug. I want to know when that's equal to 28, a total cost of 2,800. So the question is, how many mugs are you getting in this scenario? This M stands for the number of mugs. So you would just subtract 1,000 from each side, like the banking problem I did. You'd be left with $1.50 M, 1,800 here. Divided by $1.50, so 1,200. And that was the answer. Okay, two steps. Subtract and divide. It was like, these are the last three problems were all like that. Okay, let's go to the picture problem. I always seem to see this on the test, and I might give an extra credit problem that has to do with this. I can see where it is. Hold on 1 second. There are two levels to this problem. One is just to see if you can get the spacing correct in between the pictures, and then the second question at a little bit higher level, in other words, more steps, is to see if you can put the nail right in the middle of the picture. So let's read this together. I'll give you a sample problem, because possibly next time I see you, I might give it as an extra credit type problem. I usually do that in my classes, because then they get a feel for drawing the picture out as well as doing all of the equation solving that goes with it. So here's the scenario. There's 4 people in your family. There's a picture of each person that's in the family. And you want to hang up pictures of each of those 4 people. You have a wall that is 60 inches wide. Okay, so let's try and draw out what we know so far. Okay, we have a wall. We want to put 4 pictures. I mean, I think the pictures are good because they a lot of times stop you from making a mistake that seemed like it was sensible. But then when you look at it in the picture, you realize that you're not setting it up right. So anyhow, the wall is 60 inches wide. So from here to here, 60 inches. Okay, continue reading. I'm just trying to put what I know so far into my picture. Each of the picture frames is 8 inches wide. So 8 inches. Okay, then it says, let's see, where was I? To make everything look right, you want to make the wall, to make everything look right, you want to make the wall space between the edges of each frame identical. So you want all of this be the same. You want this, this, and this to be the same. And then they also say that on either end, you want those to be the same as these in-between spaces, just so it looks like all evenly spaced out. So all this problem is about hanging some pictures on a wall and trying to space them evenly. Yes, it's a math problem. Some people just kind of wing it, and then if the pictures look cockeyed, just leave it like that. But I know a lot of people that do that. But if you're trying to make it look right, it is a pretty simple math problem, and here we go. We're going to put the same amount of space between the ends of the wall, the end of the wall, and the first picture, as you are between the pictures. Each frame has a single hook in the center. Where should you put the four nails? Let's not worry about the nails right now. First, let's just get spacing right. Okay, so we have 60. I think it's pretty fair to assume that if you have 60 to work with, and this is taking up 32 of those 60 inches. So first we're going to go like this. This would be step one. Let's see how many inches are going to be swallowed up going lengthwise by just the the width of each of these pictures. So we're going to go 8 inches times 4, where I got the 32 that I was just talking about. Then we're going to say, okay, in step two, if the wall is 60 inches and 32 inches of it are swallowed up just by virtue of the pictures, and I need to subtract out 32 inches, which gives me 28. That means I have 28 inches left over for spacing. So if the question is, if one of the questions is, how much spacing should you put here, 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 and here, if you want the spacing on the ends to be the same as the spacing in between, just so it looks all nice and uniformly spaced. So you would keep going further. The next step, I'm going to put that over here just so you can see all of the steps in one screenshot. You have 28 inches left over at this point, after taking into consideration the amount of space that's going to be chewed up by this 8 times 4. And we have to divide it up into 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 spaces. What students miss when they do this is they usually use one too few. They don't like count the ends. Sometimes they use two. They don't, you know, even throw in these end spaces. They just talk about the spaces in between. But when you draw a picture of it, you can see it really clearly. There are 5 spaces here. 3 in between the pictures and the 2 that are in. So you're dividing by 5 here. Put that in your calculator. 28 divided by 5. That would be 5.6. So this is going to be 5.6 inches. All of these are going to be 5.6 inches. I'm not going to keep writing I for inches. Okay, the harder question going on to step 4 is, where does each nail go? Where do you place each nail if you want the nail to be dead center in the middle of the picture? Again, it's addition. So I think this is going to make total sense to you. When you go and why don't we do when we're doing part 4? I don't know if I'll be able to squeeze it all in here, but why don't we do where the first nail is? And we'll put the second nail in the middle of the second picture, the third nail in the middle of the third picture, and so on. So first nail, second nail. Third nail, fourth nail. Okay, so if you're going, and you can just keep track of this with your calculator, when you're going to go put the first nail in, you have to get from the end of the picture. They want to know how far from the end of the wall should you go to get the nails right in the center of each picture. So to get the first nail right in the center of the first picture, you got to go across 5.6 And then you got to go 4 inches into this center so that you're right there. So what is that? 5.6 plus 4, 9.6. Okay, let's say you're going for the second nail and that you might want to get your calculator involved. I mean, you could even use your calculator here. You could put in your calculator 5.6 to get from there to there plus 4. That'll get you right there for your first nail. And then look what you got to do if you're going to go do the second nail. You are already at 9.6. And if you want to label that, you can. That way you don't have to keep adding all the numbers from the beginning again. So you were at 9.6. You're going to do another 4. And you could keep this in your calculator and just keep adding on till you get into the middle of the second picture. You were at 9.6. You're going to do 4 more inches to get to the edge of the picture. So add on 4. You're going to do another 5.6 to get across the space in between pictures. And then you're going to go 4 more inches to get right into the center of the second picture. So add in that extra 4, and you're at 23.2. I would keep track of where these nails are. So again, so you don't have to keep adding all of this over and over again. So right now I'm at 23.2. I'm trying to figure out the third picture. Where should I put the third nail in the third picture? Like as if you had a measuring tape and you wanted to measure how far should I go so I can put a little dot right there and then put the nail there. Okay, so let's keep going. Let's keep going right off the answer we had. We had 23.2. That was the last answer I got, so I'll start right there. I'm going to have to go 4 to get to the edge, another 5.6, and another 4. And you're doing that same thing each time once you figure out the first answer. Another 4, another 5.6, another 4. Now you got the third answer, the third nail, which is 36.8. Again, I'm going to take that answer and put it right here so I can work right off that answer to get my final position of the fourth nail. Again, once you get to the, after the first answer, you're just doing this. Once you get one of the nails in place, you're adding 4 to get to the end, adding 5.6 to jump across the space, adding 4 to go halfway into the next picture. You're adding in that 4 twice and then adding the 5 points. And I was at 36.8 already, plus 4 to get to the edge, plus 5.6 to jump across the space, and plus 4 to get into that fourth picture. Or you could, you know, instead of adding 4 twice, of course, you could add just 8. So 50.4 would be the final positioning of the nail. Okay, anybody want to ask me any questions? So these are not really equations, but more of a you looking at what you're doing inside of a picture and doing multiple calculations, coming up with a plan, doing multiple calculations until you get the answer. Now I'm going to give you one that's similar. Let's just kind of get a barometer of where everybody is at. Hold on for 1 second. Let me see where I got this one. Okay, this same problem. Maybe as you read it, you're going to realize it. I'll let you look at that, and then we're going to do a poll to see how well people did. I would very much suggest drawing that, and I could even help you do the drawing. But it's the same situation. Instead of having a 60-inch wall, you have a 48-inch fence. And it doesn't even matter if you draw the You don't have to draw the whole rectangular, even though the fence is. Even though the fence is fencing in a rectangular, so there's your fence. It's 48 feet. And you're trying to put four bushes there, four bushes in place. There's your bush. All right. Okay, now these are 10 foot wide. See how similar it is to the last problem? Okay, keep going with it. Notice that it asks the same question. You want consistent spacing. You can consider this an edge, just as though it was a rectangle. You want to know what should each of these spaces be. Now here they're not asking you to put anything in the center. They just want to know where to dig the holes. Let's see if they really want what they really want here. Figure out the spacing first. Try to see if you can figure out what steps to use to try and figure out how big these spacings should be. Okay, so I'm thinking that you have probably figured out the spacing by now. Let's just talk about the answer. Okay, so it was a 48-foot fence. We have bushes that are 10 foot wide. So just 48, take off the 40 feet devoted to the width of the bushes. So that's 8. And if you want them to be equally spaced apart, now let's see what it says about the spacing. It wants consistent spacing between the bushes and between the bushes and the end of the fence. Okay, so if the fence is encapsulating the entire yard like this, surrounds the entire yard, there are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 spaces, just like we had before. So this is what we have left over after we take out the 40 for the bushes themselves. We have 8 feet of spacing left over, and we're dividing that by 5. So if we want equal spacing, that's 8 divided by, oh, is there 3 bushes? Let me look. I thought they said 4. Oh, it's 3. My bad. Let me do this again. All right, so there's one bush there, one bush there. Sorry, I read it wrong. Thank you for catching that. Okay, so let's see. We said what? 10 feet, 10 feet, and 10 feet. And this was supposed to be 48, so we can fix this pretty quick. Okay, so 48, take out 30. Then we have 18 feet of spacing left over. And so we're gonna just divide that up into, let's see, how many spaces do we have now? We have one right here, one right here, one right here, and one right here. We want those to be equal. So we're doing 18 divided by 4 because there's 4 spaces. 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, so 18 divided by 4 is 4.5. And then they do want to dig the hole in the middle. So you're going to, you know, use the same approach that you did for the last one, because you do want to center. You want to center your hole whenever you're planting something. So you do have to consider how wide the hole is. So we're going to put the 4.5 here and approach the whole rest of the problem just as we did the pictures. So where would the first hole go? For the first tree, just 4.5 and then go 5 inches in so that you're at that middle hole that you're going to dig is at, let's see, 4.5 and then an extra 5. That's because this width is 10. So the first one's going to be at 9.5, dead center to make a hole to dig the first, put the first tree in. So 9.5. And when you go to the second hole for the second tree, let's play right off that 9.5. We're at 9.5 for the center of this one. Add 4.5, add another 5 to get into the center of this hole. So I already have the 9.5. That's where I was for my first hole. And then add the 4.5 to jump across the space between the trees. And then 5 feet in to get to this, to be at the center of this tree. Okay, so then the next one is at 19. And then if you want to figure out where to put the third hole so that you can plant the third tree, then it would be 19. Let's just play off the 19 now. Jump across the space, go 5 feet in. So just the same as the last problem, only the last one had 4 pictures. This one had 3 items, 3 trees. So that last answer would be 19. plus the 4.5 to jump across the space and 5 extra feet to get into the middle of the tree. So that's 28.5. Anyway, so maybe next time we'll do something, you know, having to do with extra credit for that one. I know that one takes quite a bit of planning, but students are pretty successful with it after they do a few of these. And it does pop up quite a bit, so I just thought I'd go over that. But anyway, that is it for today. If anybody has any questions, I'll be hanging around here. I have office hours today from 11 to 12:15, and then again from 12:40. To 1:55 p.m. So if anybody needs help with anything, I will be around. I sent out an announcement to I put an announcement on your Blackboard shell and sent it to your email, the links that you can follow to join me for office hours if you need assistance. Okay, everyone, have a beautiful day, and I will see you on Thursday. Bye-bye.